something change. Because GCU selected blue. I thought they would select red.
Yeah.
I don't know what's up with that.
That's already a change. So we've got one already in there.
Yeah.
Let's see what other ones we go ahead and pile on here. Well, there's your second one. Karthus banned away first ban phase. I think Goldcoin United are probably thinking, you know what? They recognized a stark difference between their with Karthus games and without Karthus games. So they'll probably pick it up early. So let's just shut it down right now and keep Lulu away from Matt because he had some phenomenal Lulu plays.
Yeah. I wonder what TL thinks GCU is going to do and what GCU is actually going to do here because Camille, Rumble, they'll get one of them. Maybe the Rengar. Graves should be another ban that comes out. Or shouldn't if you're TL and want to trade. But these bans, because you're banning Karthus so early on, thinking that TL might take Karthus as their last pick on their first round. Ah, okay. So maybe a Rumble first pick here for Goldcoin United.
Choices and choices and decisions Team Liquid has one left to make in this banning phase.
Yeah, you have to figure out, are we banning Rumble or are we banning Graves?
What about Renekton? He's been banned.
That's true.
In all the previous matches. This could be the first one that they decide to let him pass. Maybe give that to Solo.
Yeah, but when Rumble's on the table and so is Renekton. Ah,
okay.
Leave everything up there. They ban away the Caitlyn. Make sure that there's at least trades available. If they take Rumble, you might get Renekton. If they take Graves, you can get Rengar.
Goldcoin United coming off the back of a very closely contested win. One that went way closer than they probably would have liked it to, but still just absolutely thrilled at the idea of being able to play more games and continue this series.
Yep.
Gonna lock in that Rumble first and foremost.
And that'll be the Graves for Rainover. So you're expecting some tankiness in the top lane for gank assist.
And you know, Rainover on this Graves, it's a champion that he's very effective on. It's a champion he can do a lot of work on. I was actually talking to him this past weekend, and I was like, you know, I really wish teams would stop banning that against you because you give me really great plays to cast when you're on Graves. And I always like to see the Graves, and this time, we're gonna get to see it. They're also picking up the Lucian very early for Double.
Yeah, Doublelift has been a standout here, so I definitely think you give him an early pick. That's a power pick for you. And he had to play against the Lucian previously, so now he's gonna have that in his own hands. The Caitlyn banned away, so a lane counter that would bully him out. Not available for Goldcoin United on the response.
Goldcoin United will go ahead and grab that Rengar for themselves, though, exactly like you mentioned just a couple of moments ago, Zyrene. Everything's on the table, so they pick the Graves, you pick the Rengar. You've both got strong choices. GCU has one left to pick before we go into the second ban phase, though. We'll have to see what they want to pick to complement this top lane and jungle, and it looks like it's going to be support for the Karma.
I like that because the Karma is actually a soft counter to the Rumble. The shield being used with the Mantra for the entire team makes an Equalizer actually not do even close to as much damage as you would think. A lot of the time, the Mantra shield from a Karma onto everybody doesn't get blown through because it's just so much shielding. And against a Rumble, it does exactly that. So it'll blow through the shield, but you need a lot more damage on top of it, and Rumble's not really built for that right out of the gate.
Well, to counter the Karma, they're going to go ahead and pick up the Nami on the side of Team Liquid, not willing to allow that support pick to wait until after there's already more ban opportunities for their opponents. They want to make sure that they get what they need to help Doublelift carry from that bottom lane. So lopsided picks for the fourth game in a row now. Jungler versus jungler picked, support versus support picked, but top lane versus AD carry. Means our bans are going to be looking a little bit differently focused here in the second phase as LeBlanc is banned away by Liquid. Always looking to keep Phoenix off of that one. And Nautilus is banned away from Goldcoin.
Yeah, keep him off of these tanks in the top lane for Lorlo. Yeah, make him go on to something that's maybe a little less tank and damage oriented. So this means that the Nautilus being taken away will put Lorlo on something like the Gragas, which may be another ban that comes out here. But the Maokai would be kind of an ideal matchup.
Ashe has been removed by Liquid now as well, making sure that Mash can't grab that one for himself, get some of that arrow engage potential. Because after all, this time around, Matt is not going to be playing the Tahm Kench, so you have no arrow save potential. So if they wanted to play the Ashe, it could be that much more deadly. Just going to take that one off the table instead. One last ban from Goldcoin United. Who's it going to be?
I would think it's Gragas, unless they want to go with something like a Vladimir or an Ahri for the last pick. But, okay, so the Maokai. I was thinking you would want the Maokai matchup, but I guess they think that the Gragas is less tanky and easier to deal with than a Maokai would be for Lorlo. And I guess Maokai is probably a better champion for Lorlo. I mean, the guy even has a Twitch emote of Lormao.
Does he really?
A little sapling, yeah. Because he always had to play Maokai. The guy used to be like a Riven and Fiora player, but
stark difference between those and a Maokai.
Uh-huh. Forced to play Maokai when he kind of came over to the professional scene. Playing carries in the top requires a little bit of a different skill set, because if you mess up once, you're kind of out of the game.
You're done.
Way later. If you mess up as a tank, it's all right.
It's like, I'm still tanky. I still have a Sunfire Cape and a Spirit Visage.
Exactly. I've had conversations with Lorlo about this, where his take was, if you are playing a carry top laner, you have to know all of the matchups. Every little intricacy of the tank matchups, every little intricacy of, like, when do you beat them? Is it level 9, level 8, etc.?
Well, double lift, picking up that Gragas for Lorlo. You would expect them to pick up the top laner first, considering they already know the enemy top laner. They want to save that mid lane counter pick for last. And it looks like whoever it is, they're going to be up against Phoenix's Jace as they grab that on the side of Goldcoin United, along with the Ezreal for Mash.
Really interesting from Phoenix here, taking a lot of AD. So they are putting a lot on that top lane Rumble for their AP source, which is completely fine. He'll build penetration. People will want to build armor on the enemy team. And yeah, the Taliyah here, this was something that got banned away from Piglet all day yesterday. And he also played it in all of his games on the last set that they had in the LCS.
He played it against FlyQuest and did really well on it. And that was in game number one. And then they banned it away in the other two games. And he also played it against Team Solo Mid, did not have as impressive of a showing on it then, but since then has improved on the champion. It'll be fun to see him on that one this time around. And I'm not gonna lie, Zyrene, I really like watching the Ezreal versus Lucian matchup, because as the game goes on, they both have so much potential for outplay and these really slick moves with their dashes and their skill shots. It's a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah, Lucian pretty much beats you in a one-on-one, and Ezreal, it's about spacing. He needs to stay out of Lucian's range, just out of it, and in his own range, about that 550, but also, I would say, it's fine to go to like 600 and get those cues off the Mystic shots.
Two different goals, two different play styles, but when they come together, if you've got really skilled players on both of them, which fortunately we have, can look like some sort of crazy thing out of an anime fight. And it's just the greatest thing to watch if you can manage to get a 1v1 between those two.
We had those at the Nexus last game, Ezreal versus
That's
Lucian.
What I'm talking about.
Decided those final moments in that first one.
We're loading in now to game number four between these two teams. Just to give everybody a quick recap, in case maybe you weren't here at the start, or maybe you just forgot exactly how this whole thing structured. The winner today...
I forgot.
Oh, well, allow me to remind you, Zyrene.
Go ahead.
The winner of today's best of five, they're in the LCS in summer 2017. How cool of a reward is that? That's pretty dope. But the loser today, they go on to play tomorrow against the winner of the match on the other stream. And then that winner will also go on.
So four enter, only two will move on, and two will be in the Challenger Series next split. And GCU just went through the Challenger Series. They got number one. They just took down Envy, one of the LCS teams. Now they have to take down the team that ended in ninth in TL to try and get that spot for themselves.
This will complete their holy trifecta. They beat EU United in the grand final of Challenger Series, so that's one. They beat Envy yesterday, that's two. Now you just got to complete the triangle, take down Team Liquid if you want to punch that ticket first and foremost into LCS Summer Split 2017. But to do that, you got to find two more wins here on Summoner's Rift.
The reverse sweep.
The reverse
would
sweep
would be very difficult to do. From a mental standpoint, it is hard to say, all right, you know, it was just the, it wasn't the composition, it was the execution, it was the call in game one. So they go with pretty much the same composition. Doesn't work out again. Then they start respecting the Karthus, but you're already with your backs against the wall, spending a ban on a champion that you weren't planning to, and now they've gone over to blue side, got themselves a rumble, so it looks a little bit better for them. But now, the question mark is, Doublelift has Lucian, and Piglet has Taliyah, comfort for two of these guys. And Rainover on that Graves.
And Rainover on the Graves. This has been banned away in both, well, all three of the previous matches, I should say. Excited to see what he can do on the champion. We already talked about how he's got a reputation for being able to make big plays on this, being able to get a lot done. And we'll have to see if the Goldcoin United plan of actually allowing it through this time will pay off. Because they will be up against that, up against the Piglet Taliyah that you talked about, the double lift pocket pick on the Lucian. So a lot of comfortable choices here on the side of Team Liquid, looking to win this game and end this series. Get out of the promotion tournament very early. Matt on the Nami. Again, going to be on one of those types of champions that not quite as save heavy as like a Lulu is, but still, you're going to be hanging back. You're going to be protecting your own team, just ensuring that double lift can be that carry.
Definitely a bit for lane as well, where he can constantly sustain and help double lift out. Whereas before, he's kind of picking stuff that doesn't really help you too much in the lane. Matt being a little bit aggressive. Oh, he wanted to get the bounces there, or at least a bounce.
Those bounces are such a powerful trading mechanism, too, because you think about it, you look at it, and it's damage plus healing onto you, so it's just both ways. Like, that's really, really good.
Yeah, it makes trading pretty simple. Rain over, level 3 gank, 2 minutes, 40 seconds onto Solo, and he's got a red buff.
This is going to put some serious pain into Solo. No real kill potential, but he knocks off a third of his health bar.
That was actually super good by Solo to ward at that time, because that is an unusual gank time. That is what Chaser did for Someday. When he was playing Rengar, it was a 2 minute and 40 second gank where you do your Raptors, you do your red buff, you do your Krugs, not completely, but you'll hit level 3 and then you run up there. And most people have an internal gank timer of about 3 minutes when people will show up. And that was right on time where Solo places the ward and spots Rain over as he's coming out of the bush.
The fan vote for game number 4 shrunk back down a little bit. It changed because we were originally at 53, so we changed 1%.
Yep.
Man.
Went up 1% for TL.
The thing is, though, it's never been further apart than 10. Like the 40-60 thing. Well, technically 20, I guess. Yeah, whatever. 40 to 60. It's never been further apart than that this whole time, which is very, very close between these two squads. Shows how evenly matched they are. The fans realize it. We're realizing it. It's turned out to be a pretty solid series so far.
Yeah, and we kind of said that might happen after the first game with the laning phase and how everything was so equal, which was unexpected. But we see Piglet without having the Karthus here in easy mode, and we see Mash and Madlife not having the Zyra Caitlyn bottom lane or the Zyra Ashe.
The auto shove, the just destroy your opponent in lane. They're not really allowed to do anything. Sort of, it almost turns the bottom lane into a PvE experience because all you do is just kill the minions and then the enemy players aren't allowed to do anything back to you.
Yeah, it can quickly turn into, if the other players are not playing well, them being PvP'd down. Not much you could say about it, but...
Oh,
nice.
Good combo damage coming out there from Piglet, who fires that threaded volley right back into Phoenix as he jumps onto him.
Yeah, Phoenix actually winning that trade. I'm sorry, Piglet actually winning that trade because the threaded volley, as soon as the Q to the skies from Phoenix was coming out, just hits all of them in the face and actually returns more damage. Still has a potion as well, has a biscuit. So Piglet's actually in a much better spot than Phoenix is at the moment.
Piglet continuing to just shove this wave up. Talia is so darn good at it too. Always shove it up, always just clearing out the waves. Phoenix has to get himself back right now. Quick look at the summoner spells that we're seeing this game because they are a little bit different. Two heals. Over there as Rainover tries to steal away some of these Raptors. End of the line, not quite going to find the kill. Santorin just smacks it down instead.
Yeah, Rainover actually a little bit behind in CS, dropped some of those small Krugs. And right there what happened was Santorin leaped in, got himself right onto it and smited it. I believe he actually got that one away from Rainover.
I didn't realize that when that skin backs for Lucian, it's such a cool saxophone sound playing
sexy
too.
Sexy sax, mate.
Yeah. That's really cool. All right. I now realize why everybody uses that Lucian skin. That's sweet. All right. Double lift, though. Him and Matt doing a good job so far in this lane. 49 to 42, getting a slight CS advantage for themselves, but their team down in gold overall. The gold difference between the junglers and the top laners telling the story of that for now, just with those slight farm leads. But double lift and Matt, finally, like you mentioned, a little bit of just breathing room in the bottom lane.
Yeah, you know? Room to flex their muscles in the superior bottom lane. Having this pick and not having the same ones for Goldcoin United, the Caitlyn ban for Mash, making sure that he has to at least play slightly risky underneath these turrets.
Solo and Lorlo. Now, we've seen different things from these two throughout the course of this series. Like, Lorlo was so dominant in the first couple of games, and in the last game, he wasn't able to pull off nearly as much on the Fizz.
Yeah, the double bans towards him with the Camille and Rumble, making sure he doesn't get a first pick Camille, definitely threw a wrench into his plan. But we saw some adjustments. We saw Solo not die as much either, and not get camped as hard. He was able to actually turn around a 2v1 under turret. Almost got a kill on both of the guys that dove him. Talia, though, has ulti. This is what you're waiting for.
All right. Wait, made his way
it's
up short.
Fight, but okay, it's short a little bit. Jumps himself back over the wall. Piglet gonna be brought very, very low. First blood actually goes the way of Goldcoin United. Rainover and Lorlo looking to make their way into the fight. Matt gonna be here now as well, too. Rainover goes down. Santorin gonna be taken down very low as well. A double kill for Matt, of all people, evening this up 2-2.
That big difference there was the support showed up. Matt was there, was able to contribute all of his spells and an ignite on top of it, where Madlife had just backed. Lorlo hits solo this way, but then they're actually going to collapse. The Rengar ultimate gets popped. They see Piglet puts himself on the opposite side of the wall, and so Santorin has to jump all the way through. The Equalizer not really going to do anything in that fight, but solo then has Matt on the backside, gets picked up, a great bubble from him onto Santorin, and then the auto attacks pick him up afterwards. And that's just exactly, like, as soon as that fight ended, we saw Madlife kind of coming by the wolf camp. He's super far away. Matt was just way earlier to the roam, and that was one that was started by TL. They knew it was coming, right? They send Matt there, Lorlo's gonna cask him back, Piglet's gonna try to Talia wall him, and then they're gonna fight.
I mean, if Matt's not there, that would have been a slaughter.
Yeah,
that would have been just pure GCU plays left, right, and center, saving the day by making sure he works his way up there. Double lift, bottom side, not really struggling with the loss of his support there for a couple of moments. Still with the CS lead, still doing great.
Yeah, Madlife tried to roam as well, right, and spent about the same amount of time roaming around. This is going to be Matt with a bit of an advantage with those two kills, of course, in himself.
Not really where you'd like to see him. I mean, we'd like to see them somewhere else.
Yeah, that's true. You definitely want them on things like your Graves or Talia. I would say even in that top lane. But solo is somebody who picked up a kill, and so did Santorin. So Bones and Necklace a little bit online, and solo getting that penetration build going.
Double lift and Matt. Just want to hit that point with the Blade of the Ruined King, because, you know, we talked in the previous game a little bit, we at least mentioned it in passing, that when Double Lift Ezreal had a Mana Moon and he had a Sheen, completed Blade of the Ruined King was up for mash. Mm-hmm. So you're really scary as the Lucian once you have that completed item versus just kind of those mana-based items.
Right? It's so hard to get you out of lane, too. It heals for a lot, the increase on lifesteal, the Piglet.
Seismic Shove did not go where he needed it to go.
Well, he actually was expecting Santorin to leap at him. And so he was putting it on himself preemptively to knock Santorin into turret if he leaped.
A solid prediction, but just didn't quite look as cool since it wasn't quite where it needed to be. Infernal Drake started up by Team Liquid, but then canceled. It's back, Zyrene, the one that they'll fight each other for.
I know you're ready for this.
You think they would have tried that if it wasn't a Cloud Drake? They wouldn't have.
Speaking of fighting each other for something, teleport onto Mash and Madlife.
Trying to find this with the Tidal Wave. Flash going to be used. Mash getting himself away. Madlife going to be flashing now as well. Lorlo looking to flash deep under enemy territory. Madlife going to be knocked back. A little bit more damage. He's healed up until Rainover shoots him down, but it's going to be one for one. Now, GCU looking to make even more out of it. A two for one, grabbing the kill onto Double Lift. Oh, baby, I think we're going to make it a triple. Phoenix grabbing the third member of Team Liquid now as they only lost their support for it. Goldcoin United for the second time this game. Liquid looks to make a play, and Goldcoin says, nah, I think we'll do that instead. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to welcome everyone from the other stream, from NALCS2. You're jumping into Goldcoin United versus Team Liquid. It's now 1-2. Goldcoin United just won game number 3 after one hell of a battle. And here in game number 4, they are looking very, very strong to start things off.
Santorin Smite, there you go. Picks up the first Infernal Drake of the game. Next one will be Mountain. And yes, you said they won that hell of a fight in game 3. This is a hell of a fight in game 4 to start this one off here. GCU, Madlife. Make some work for it. Then Rainover pops the ultimate. Great equalizer this time to get the flash out of Double Lift. And then Santorin flashes to the other side of the bush to get a leap onto Double Lift and continue. Whereas Phoenix had roamed down and Piglet was still clearing out mid lane. So we're seeing these fights go the way of the team that, of course, has the superior numbers in the roam. And who's there faster?
Team Liquid down 600 gold based off of the way these fights have been going. Still no turrets having been taken, but Goldcoin United with an Infernal Drake under their belts. Zyrene, when you've got a team like Rumble, like Rengar, like Jace, those Infernals are juicy.
Oh, they're real good.
They're gonna make a difference.
Oh, they are really good. Especially when you're looking at something like the Rengar that can start snowballing and getting even more AD, because it's like AD for his AD.
Hey, I heard you like AD.
Because it's funny because his ratio is a bonus attack damage ratio, and then his Bone Tooth Necklace gives you bonus attack damage based off your bonus attack damage.
So now that you've got more bonus attack damage, you're going to have some more bonus attack damage,
exactly.
Which will give you some bonus attack damage.
It's just like Varus gets more bonus attack speed off his bonus attack speed.
Compounding stats. Multiplicative bonuses. That's that feel-good stuff. Piglet feeling good about dodging away from that Shock Blast as well. Gets himself back into mid lane with the Rock Surfing. It's a really cool passive, honestly. I always like the fact that she has she like surfs along with that. I always thought that was a pretty cool idea.
Yeah, it was kind of mixed. A lot of people were like, oh, it's not that great. And some people were
but
like,
it
wait,
looks cool.
Movement speed?
It looks cool, though.
Yeah, it definitely looks great. I love how nearby a wall, it just pops up. Sometimes when you're like traveling, though, you'll like jump on it and then jump off and then jump on it and jump
off.
Yeah,
that's a little bit troll. Did you ever play Jak and Daxter 2 on PlayStation?
I did not.
You had a hoverboard in that game that was a lot like Taliyah's, and the fastest way to get around in the game was to get on it and then get off of it, and get on it and then get off of it, and get on it and then get off of it. Yeah.
And I love it
brings
when
me back.
Love when people find those mechanics or those things that save you frames. So you watch like speed runs of Ocarina of Time, they're backflipping the whole time, and you're not even watching where you're going.
Yeah.
Link is just back.
Yeah, it's just back. Yeah. Weird speedrun stuff. I've seen people jump on and off that jetboard so many times. Sometimes you shoot yourself up 100 feet in the air with it. I don't know how any of it works, but... See, rock surfing's a little bit easier to understand.
Double if, though.
All he understands is war. Jumping into Mash's face, pulling the guns, getting ready.
I do like it, though, because Mash doesn't really have a way to sustain himself outside of the potions, whereas Double if has the lifesteal from Bill's Water Cutlass, and he also has a Nami. So trading is mostly in your favor, unless it's an all-in. And Madlife just has to be really fast on getting those shields down. TL, though, looks like they're trying to get a roam down here. Phoenix is coming up from GCU. And so is Piglet.
Oh, Santorin going to be taken very, very low. Double if popping the heal, trying to stay alive.
Oh,
one more auto attack gets it! Goldcoin United's got themselves what they came for, but now can they get out without too many casualties? Rainover looking to come in, maybe secure a kill. Ultimate not going to be finding the mark. Comes in with the flash. We're going to get one more auto attack. End of the line seals the deal instead. One for one.
And teleports on the top laners. Pretty close to coming back right before that fight. Just seconds off of that, so they couldn't join in. But both teams have the same idea. Time to fight on the bottom side of the map. Get yourself in there. Saw Phoenix roaming ahead of time. Piglet at the same moment is also realizing the same thing. And this game, it's being super close. All throughout this series, we're seeing some early leads for one team or the other, but it never seems to be enough except for that game three to really just completely snowball out of control. These teams are quite evenly matched. Since this bottom lane, this game, Double if, not getting that edge over Mash. And that mid lane, it's even right now between Phoenix and Piglet. Both teams are playing around their strengths right now.
Last auto attack from Mash, making sure they got Double if, very important.
Because he already had a lot of stacks of Fervor, so it's a little bit deceptive of how much damage that was going to do.
Especially considering it is Mana Moon, Sheen, Ezreal. You expect the Mystic shots to hurt, but the rest, not really so much. But Fervor really adds up.
Yeah, I don't believe he had Sheen at the time of death. No, he didn't.
All right.
But it was still...
Slight mistake, Areno.
Yeah, still Mana Moon, but the Fervor stacking up is just a lot of damage when you're able to get that.
We still got a very close game here, though. 1,000 gold separating the teams, so a decent little lead for Goldcoin United, but nothing they can write home about just yet. Nothing they can start making plays around and building their lives around. They got to make sure that they're still playing this one as smooth as they can, trying to find every opportunity. Mountain Drake going to be alive here in about 50 seconds.
Yeah.
Might be looking to fight over that one.
And this is also the first time that we've seen Solo with an advantage. You think back to game one, 0-3-1 up against Lorlo. Game two, pretty much the same. Got destroyed. Game three... fended off the dive, and then was sort of
like
able
break,
to keep
he was
up.
Breaking even.
Yeah, but this is where he has like a clear advantage. He has the kills. He's the rumble. He's the sole source of AP damage on this GCU team. He has to do well, and he's doing well.
2-1-2. He's got the Liandry's Torment completed, and we've seen mid-game fights before just end because of rumble ultimates.
Oh yeah,
this is a champion that has the fate of the game sometimes in his hands when it comes to these mid-game fights in jungle corridors or dragon pits that he's tightly grouped areas, so eyes on Solo to see what he can do with those, with the TP available to come into these fights if they're going to be breaking out around this Drake.
Fighting over this Drake right here. fighting over vision control. Jungler's doing all the dirty work as the mid laners try to fight over that wave. And nice hit on the Piglet.
Poke each other. Yeah, Piglet gonna lose about a third of his HP just from that accelerated shock blast. Those things are no joke. If you can manage to line those up, really poke people down. That was just a normal one.
Oh, speaking of shock blast, we'll see if he gets an acceleration key here on Piglet. Oh,
he did it! He did ride it!
So it dismounts you on damage, and I'm pretty sure he had a Deathfire touch kick.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. Fair enough.
Yeah, he had a Leandre's tick. So he started it, and the Leandre.
The Leandre burned him as soon as he jumped up and tried to ride the ice thing.
Yep.
All right, fair enough. Piglet with no way out, gives it his best shot, but his best was not good enough this time. Gold Coin United going up 7-4, using that Rumble ultimate. They get Piglet's flash, too. You get the flash, and you still get the kill. Always feels good. Mad Life and Double Lift. Now getting into a little bit of a scuffle as Double puts some bullets into Mash as well.
Send them with hearts. And now
bullets with love.
A little extra behind him, but yeah. Double Lift has so much lifesteal with the Blade of the Ruined King now and has Matt to sustain him that you don't really win this lane unless it's an all-in from Gold Coin United or they get some help. That top lane turret actually looked like it was fairly low, half HP. So Solo's been able to do some work here. These guys teleported out of the lane earlier. Haven't seen too much help actually come up here for either side except for that skirmish really early on.
Honestly, I can't believe that we're 18 minutes, almost 19 minutes into the game, and there's still no turret first blood.
Mm-hmm.
Neither team has really been able to make that happen so far. Neither one has found the opportunity to get the rotation that results in.
Yeah, and that kind of is a testament to how even this game is right now. We're seeing roams to different areas of the map where even Phoenix and Piglet have both left lane to go bottom, and they both ended up with kills. Instead of have, or both ended up with helping getting kills, but it didn't end up in a turret, so there was counter kills in both of those moves.
Piglet has been two of his team's deaths so far, although he's also been involved in 3 out of 4 kills. Unfortunately for him, hasn't got any of those under his belt specifically. You have to see if he can really get this Taliyah going as we move further into the mid game. Rainover and Matt trying to take away this Mountain Drake without too much of an issue, but the ward dropped over the wall by Mad Life. The Gold Coin United is going to be aware of what's happening. Rainover decides to drag it out of the pit.
We're going to let it go.
First. We'll do it. Yep. Gold Coin United decides to let that one pass. Not worth fighting it.
Yeah. Seems like Santorin was not in a position to actually contest for it, and they were waiting on that. He was back. Had to spend some of that gold being 3-1-3.
Actually, hit the first world problems. I've got too much money.
Yeah, actually,
got to go back to the base.
Pretty much clearing camps. He's sitting on 1,200 gold, so he could actually buy Dead Man's Plate. And right here, we see Rainover coming in.
Double Lift wanting to make the move.
Whoa!
Mad Life going to be taken very low. Flashes just south of where that ultimate was going to be finding its way. But Phoenix makes sure he seals Piglet's fate there near the mid lane. 8-4 now, Gold Coin United with a nice solo kill.
All right, I was saying that, you know, the skill difference wasn't rearing its ugly head just yet.
Now
right there. That was Phoenix having control of mid lane and seeing that Piglet wanted to roam and possibly be a part of that play. So he cut him off instead of roaming as well and went for the 1v1.
Phoenix now doing everything he can to bring this down. Get that turret first blood. Barely missing out on it. He and Rainover both taken critically low.
He went in on Rainover, had to blow his heal, but Rainover had to blow Flash.
Double Lift and Matt barely keeping their turret alive as well. So many of these turrets, and by so many I mean two
mid
of these turrets, very, very close to death. Phoenix grabbing the turret first blood, finally 21 minutes into the game.
Yep, taking that one up for himself, whereas his bottom turret. Now you can start flexing things around. Start putting your bottom lane mid if you want. But I feel like you do want this turret first, so I think they'll come back here, and then you get a roam from Phoenix.
Speaking of Phoenix, Edge of Night just now completed for him, so gonna have that much more playmaking and play denying ability with the power of that spell shield.
Yeah, making sure Piglet might not be able to knock him into the team. Right now, see what happens next, because Phoenix, you would think, goes mid, clears it out, tries to shove it maybe to tier 2 and advance ward lines, and then go bottom to try and get that turret, because that one is just really fast, even just a wave and 2 seconds. Even a second, I would say, would get you that bottom lane turret.
Gold Coin have built this lead up to about 3,000 now. Still some standing gold waiting to be claimed on that bottom turret as well.
Blade of the Ruined King done on double lift, working on that Black Cleaver. Pretty much the standard build you're seeing out of Lucian's these days. Orc into BC, accepted by many as incredibly effective. Phoenix popping the edge of Knight, but can't get in range to do anything here to Piglet.
And double lift is also going to go for a Ninja Toppy here because it's up against 3 AD, and the 1 AP is Solo. And I will say, though, Solo is quite fed, so that is still going to devour the Lucian if a... Sax gets me every time.
Yep. Every single time. You just gotta slow down and respect it. Santorin trying to get some damage onto double lift and Matt here, but instead gets bubbled up and sort of stopped in his tracks. Culling used to get rid of the minion wave, try to hold onto this turret, but no dice. It's gonna be a 2-0 turret lead for the side of Gold Coin.
Nice. So Santorin comes bottom to help them push it in, whereas Phoenix continues to push up mid, make sure that there's no Talia Realm. So the options there were you either get Phoenix blue buff really early, and then you do something like that, or you do it in reverse order and risk your blue buff being taken, but it seems like Rainover was on the bottom side of the map, and they wanted to just make sure that they get the turret. There wasn't really a risk that they lose anything on the top side either, which is strange. This is actually the least topside-focused game in the series so far.
Solo just being left to his own devices. He's got the Zhonya's Hourglass up and working too, which, considering Rumble still shoots out the Flame Spitter, while Zhonya's can be very, very deadly, very effective in the middle of these teamfights. Lets him go in a lot more bravely as well. If he just wants to get in there, turn the flames on, and start cooking everybody, he can do it without the worry of being immediately exploded and losing that damage potential for his team.
Yeah, and Solo, it's interesting to watch him as a player, because I've talked about how, you know, he tilts and like wants to play and not be carried. But when he's on carries like Renekton or Rumble, which are the two that I really know him for, he looks fantastic. Solo's a guy that can throw down those equalizers and have them really change the flow of a team fight. And if you think back to Solo's played some games in the LCS.
Uh-oh, Piglet. This little piggy went home. Santorin gonna be the one sending him there. 40 seconds later, his screen's gonna go back to full vivid color, but for now, it's a 5 versus 4. Gold Coin United cannot stop finding the picks.
That was a great equalizer to start off there, up against the wall where Piglet has to flash to even go anywhere, or he has to walk towards the Rumble that was running at him. So, gives him kind of a catch-22, which is exactly what you want with that ultimate, where you have pretty much no option except for the option that your enemy wants you to take and is prepared for. But yeah, like I said, Solo has actually played some games in the LCS. He was part of the Ember team, and then he subbed in for Echo Fox. And also, he was one game away from beating Echo Fox in the promotion tournament. Last split, look at this, Phoenix on double lift.
Phoenix trying to make the
move,
but the hero of the day. Matt shows up to keep his AD carry alive. Both summoner spells had to be expended by Phoenix there. He would have got the kill if not for Matt showing up, firing off the tidal wave, and getting that heal in there.
Yeah, Matt. He's actually been having a pretty good series, I would say. Contrary to what happened yesterday, where he died a few times on Lulu, first blooded in the lane phase, Matt's been playing well. His Tahm Kench looked pretty clean. His laning phase has been good, even in bad matchups. And in this one, the roam was right on point. Out-roamed Madlife, got 2 kills for himself, this time right there in time to save double lift.
And that's one of the players we've been looking to step up on this squad from Team Liquid. One of the guys that, like we mentioned earlier, has endured a lot of the blame from fans and foes alike of Team Liquid, saying, Matt's dying too much. He's making too many mistakes. He needs to fix this. And if he can get up there and keep double lift going, keep him alive, 2-0-2 so far on the Nami, 100% kill participation, these are the kind of games that the fans want him to have.
Oh, looking on.
But speaking of games that the fans want you to have, pretty sure they wouldn't like to see Piglet repeat this one too often.
That was a super good equalizer too. The fact that it took a little bit of that pathway and then it was diagonal up means that he knows Piglet doesn't have flash, can't flash that wall. So
you're just stuck.
But the only way to walk around that is you have to walk closer to the Rumble and then walk all the way down and around. It's actually incredibly well placed, and that's kind of showing why GCU picked blue side for this first pick Rumble.
Goldcoin United just took an inhibitor for free at 26 minutes into the game.
Nothing's for free, but it was that Rumble equalizer for sure.
Okay, we spent the Rumble equalizer for an inhibitor. That's a good deal. You ever go to like a garage sale and you ask them, hey, how much is this thing? And they're like, oh, I don't know, just give me a nickel. Because they don't really know what it costs. And they're like, I don't really care, just get rid of it. That's what that was. That was a just give me a nickel inhibitor.
That was like a make sure you, can you carry it to your own car?
Yeah, if you can carry it out, you can have it.
I will tell you though, it was, they lost top turret for that. So they did lose their top turret.
Okay, all right, that makes it seem like a little bit more of a trade, but that's still way in the favor
of gold.
Definitely in their favor.
Right, yeah, right.
That's the nickel trade right there.
Okay, top lane turret's worth at least a little bit more than a nickel. It's like, give me a dollar, right? If we're calling an equalizer a nickel, we'll call a top lane turret a dollar. But it's still real cheap, considering that inhibitor has a lot of inherent value in it. Going to be putting some more map pressure down now for free for GCU. I know you said not for free, but if an inhibitor's down and minions are just spawning, we're not paying nothing for them.
That's true. You might be right there.
All
right.
We've got some freebies as Matt getting himself caught out. Fish out of water. Mash grabbing the kill there. Mash, not Matt. Too many M's.
You got mad. You got mash.
Mad.
You got Matt.
Mash.
You almost had ash.
Yeah. A lot of those.
Yeah, Rainover, though, actually looking at his build, went for a Bloodthirster as his second item. No Black Cleaver here because there's really not a whole lot of armor. Maybe it would help, though, but you are going to have a Black Cleaver on double lift. So Rainover's just looking for some extra oomph behind his burst combo and some sustain.
All right, more damage coming in. Goldcoin United, they've got such a huge lead. They want to push this into a victory. Take this to game number 5. This is the most convincing they have looked.
Exactly, and this is a clean execution here so far. They got that middle inhibitor off of catching Piglet, and now they're gonna rotate towards top. Rumble's flanking, has the equalizer. Where's it gonna be from solo to start off this fight if they go for a dive?
Piglet doing a good job clearing these minion waves away for now. Solo still just off in the flank waiting. He wants to pull this trigger. But GCU decides to back away from it. They've got a large wave of minions pushing up at the bottom side. You can see the ping from Team Liquid onto that one right now, saying somebody's got to get down here and deal with this.
Yeah, they have all three waves controlled. So they get the bait Baron.
Uh-oh. Rainover getting himself caught out. A rampage for Mash.
And this is so good by GCU. When you have all three waves pushing in, you can go and bait the Baron, even if it's for a quick second, because you will most likely catch a straggler. Because if they don't send their full team, then they're losing parts of their base. You're having super minions push in, your bottom turret's taking damage, your top turret's taking damage if they send 5 people in. If they send like 2 people in, which is what they were trying to do with Rainover, they're gonna get caught like that. So it was a great bait from GCU to use the advantage of their lanes.
Phoenix recognizing that something was probably up in that brush, sends an accelerated shock blast in there just to check. Madlife now targeted by Team Liquid, but the Baron's being brought down very rapidly. Equalizer gonna be used to scare him away. Lorlo tries to make his way in there, but Smite secured by Santorin. Double at very low HP. Lorlo is gonna be the sacrificial lamb. Piglet cannot get the wall in there in time to save anyone. And that's Baron Nashor going the way of Goldcoin United, 29 minutes in. There was also a ping from Goldcoin just a little bit before the Baron onto the enemy Nexus, showing that one of those turrets was very low.
Yeah. That bottom turret's also really low right now. That top turret is about half HP, and that one right there that we saw, pretty damaged. So there's a lot here for GCU to take. GCU, if they continue to execute like this, they would be bringing us to a game 5.
There's opportunity everywhere for Goldcoin United right now. This is their game. This is the game. Last game was the one where they got to hang on, where they had to just grab for dear life and hope they didn't slip away. This is their momentum game. This is them taking that win from game number 3, pushing it forward. Rainover's gonna be taken very, very low, and Phoenix with the fadeaway rampage. Goldcoin United dead set on bringing us to game 5.
Now they're gonna push up mid with Santorin. They're gonna make sure that they don't really care about this bottom turret. Even though it's super low, it doesn't have a minion wave even close because it got pushed out by Lucian. Mid and top are the two you wanna focus on. Middle inhibitor looks like it'll be back in a few seconds here. So they're hanging around this, they're getting that top turret. They're gonna push these two waves in and keep pressure so that they can't push the bottom side and even try to make anything out of that with this Baron buff.
Everyone ready to go. Goldcoin United with 4 in the top side, 1 there in the middle. Rengar ultimate gonna be used
for a flank.
Equalizer comes down, redemption cast to keep Piglet a little bit safer, but the inhibitor turret falls. Inhibitor now the target. Liquid trying to find an opportunity to defend here, but they just can't do it. They're down 11,000 gold at 31 minutes.
And the middle inhibitor's about to respawn here, so they're actually gonna back off, reset, and then come back for this one. And then they'll go mid and bottom. And the Infernal Drake will be up in 40 seconds. So, predicting how this game will go, bottom tier 2, push up mid, look at tier 2, look at the inhibitor turret, and look at the middle inhibitor, and then eventually go for the Infernal Drake. If a fight doesn't happen, then you do that. If a fight does happen and you win it, you just end the game.
You win the game. The game's over, you're going to game 5. Goldcoin. Looks like they're going to be doing just that, marching solo down the solo lane. Everybody else going to be hanging around, moving their way up towards enemy territory as well. You can see Santorin
and Mash a little bit further behind.
Yeah, Mash picking up the red buff for himself, and now they have to invade. They don't have their sweeper up anymore. Let's try to look for the blue buff here.
Ooh.
Look for Rainover.
Really aggressive. Through shot. Okay. Good foresight from Rainover, recognizing that was going to be coming through, getting himself back. But now that he's that low, tier 2 falls, no contest. Tier 3 is the name of the game.
Yep, looking for that inhibitor turret. Mad Life taking some damage, but putting down control wards and wards on the other side. Here comes this turret.
And the damage just comes in so fast, Zyrene. There's not really a lot they could do about this.
And Santorin pops the ulti just to zone.
Tidal Wave doesn't hit anyone. Liquid's running out of resources.
Yeah, they don't really have much left. Top side is going to have these super minions pushing in. And now they're spread thin. Middle minion wave can be pushed up. Bottom minion wave can as well.
I mean, you've still got ults. You've still got summoner
spells. Look at
Burning
Gate.
Now they're looking to make the plays. Trying to knock their opponents around. The health bar's rapidly deteriorating. Rainover and Lorlo both going to be killed now. Double is going to be going down next. Make it mad instead. Double barely staying alive, but not for long. A double kill for Solo. It's a 4-for-1. Mash falls, but takes the enemy team with him. And Gold Coin United will take us to game number 5.
After an epic game 3 and a more controlled game 4 from GCU, we're going to game 5. We're looking at match point, LCS point for both of these teams.
We could not have asked for a better series for this promotion tournament today, Zyrene. Both of these teams want this so bad, and it is so evident.
The reverse sweep within grasp for Gold Coin United, the number one challenger team, almost has it.
And these scores, these are as convincing as what Team Liquid was doing earlier. This game ended 18-5 with a 15,000 gold deficit, 4-1-7 on your Rumble, 5-1-7 on the Rengar, 4-0-7, the only person in the game who did not die at all for Phoenix, his second game in a row of just having phenomenal numbers.
Yeah, highest damage in the game as well for Phoenix. Solo, a little bit behind him, but also Mash did about twice double lifts damage this game. So we're looking at a Poke Ezreal doing a bit more than the Lucian, but I want to say this game was very clever from GCU because I thought GCU was just going to go back to red side and do exactly what they did again. Mm-hmm. But they changed it up. Instead, they pick blue side. They make sure that their top laner, who hasn't really had a great game, gets a good champion for himself in the meta, is able to get some attention, destroys Lorlo in the one-on-one, gets himself like, you know, a large advantage here in terms of the kills that happen. So they put action top, then they said leave top alone, let's go bottom, and then they just kept going bottom. It was the most bottom-focused game of the series so far, where they just kept ganking it over and over again, making sure double lift couldn't really do much.
And for a team that looked like they were going to close game 3 a little bit quicker, and then they had the throws and things went way too close, it's got to be comforting, reassuring for Gold Coin United to lock the game away as quickly as they did and as cleanly as they did.
Yeah, I will say that it was a game that you definitely want to just get to that next one, right? Make sure that this one is over and you aren't just completely taxing yourself through the best of 5. But this next game is the hardest game for both teams. If somebody makes a mistake, maybe you're not in the LCS and you have to play that other team that won on the other stream. So that's the big thing here. A lot of people just don't want to be that guy, but I feel like both these teams have people who step up and will make those plays.
We're going to go ahead and send things over to Dash and Azale for a closer look at exactly how GCU tied up the series.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. I can't believe I'm about to say we're going to a game 5 in this series. It looked over, as we mentioned, in game 3 when Team Liquid was able to kind of claw their way back into it. But now the momentum just feels like it's completely swung in the other direction. And I'm worried for any Liquid fans out there moving into game 5 now.
Yeah, I think a lot of Liquid management, the players, everyone I think gets a little bit nervous when you start going to a game 5.
Yeah.
Because we have seen the dominance of Phoenix throughout the series, but we had not seen is Solo taking over and the other lanes really getting advantages, like Mash, you know, getting so much more damage out than double lift. And when you get those edges elsewhere on the map, it's similar to the Envy thing with Lyra, where the whole team can be unlocked.
And that's to Zyrene's point about, you know, here in game 4, swapping up the sides, GCU coming in and say, we're going to take blue. Let's completely throw pick ban on its head, show priority to our top lane pick, get him something that can completely take over a game, put out a large amount of DPS. And so then you're not relying on Phoenix to be your solo team fight winner. He can go back to one of those more single target poke champions, lane dominant Jace play.
Yeah, and I mean, he did look great on the Jace. I still feel like Teamfight champions are going to be very good for him because
yes.
he's always getting an advantage, and that does kind of guarantee you a way to have a chance in a game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you go on the Jace, if you don't dominate, if something goes bad, then you're not necessarily going to take over a Teamfight, which is kind of a concern to me. But that said, it's what he's been doing is working, right? And Piglet is the really big concern for TL now because he's been getting smashed every game, and he's not really found a way to be super useful in anything except the Karthus.
And that's the thing, and that's the problem. I don't know how you adjust with that in mind. You have to assume that the Karthus ban is going to come through again. Great. So what do we do on the side of the Team Liquid? The Taliyah pick's not working. The Ahri, there was some influence or some effectiveness in the play. Well, I mean, in terms of...
Oh, he influenced the game,
yeah, exactly.
Just with the other
well,
team.
Within replays themselves, right, we're seeing some good charms land in one fights, but overall still not impressive in lane and still getting out to such a deficit that it's not worth it.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. What's the next pick you go to? I mean, do you put him on something entirely different or put him onto a tank in the mid lane and put Lorlo onto a carry champion in the top? What's the solution?
To me, it's hard to answer because I don't know enough of his champion pool.
That's right, yeah.
Like, he's played so many different things that if I'm saying, okay, you can play every mid lane champion reasonably well,
right.
Then I put this guy on literally something like solo lane Lulu, solo lane Karma, put him on Morgana, put him on like any supportive type champion where you can literally just sit back and wave clear and then be useful for your team.
What about Corki?
In the rest of the fight?
He's an AD carry. Why don't we throw an AD carry mid? Can Varus
like
make his trip back mid? We saw Lucian locked in mid lane in the LPL last night. That could maybe be an answer. I don't know. I'm trying to come up with possible strategies here just as you are, but maybe you do look for something like throwing another AD carry into the mid lane and playing that style, something that he's at least used to.
I mean, it's possible, but to me, that they match up so poorly 1v1. He's already getting blasted so hard by Phoenix that I don't think you can do it. To me, you look for what is the champion I can be the most useful on after I lose lane.
Right.
Because you're going to lose lane.
Mm-hmm.
He loses lane every game.
And then...
So, get him on something that's supportive, right? Like, you can be down 50 CS on a Karma
right.
and build a Locket, build an Ardent Sensor, build totally defensive, and shield up double lift and still have some use.
We talk a lot about Team Liquid because they're the team that's now on the back foot. Let's just close this out with GCU. I mean, for them, I think it's about keeping the momentum going forward and definitely, but not overreaching, right?
Yeah.
The way you lose this game is by overreaching, maybe getting too aggressive in an early tower dive and handing over those kills in Goldie to Team Liquid that we know they can run away with if gifted over to them.
Yeah, definitely. I think you have to play a little bit conservatively. Allow Phoenix to get his edges. Don't feel like the other lanes have to force, but go for them when they are there, right? You need to not be too hesitant, and you need to take advantages where you can find them.
All righty, cue up the Silver Scrapes, ladies and gentlemen, because this series is headed for the first Game 5 of the 2017 season. Can't believe that's happening. After our break, we'll see if Liquid can rather take on Gold Coin United, or if they're going to claim their first spot in the summer split.
If he goes to me, we win. If he goes to me, we win. Help Jaehoon.
Help Jaehoon.
That's the low.
Keep going. Keep back. I hate Lucian.
Go to Leah.
Back.
Keep going. Base. I got him.
Nice.
Go base.
We can end.
Can I?